The Soviet government initially provided liquidators with minimal protective gear and did not equip them with dosimeters to accurately measure the radiation exposure. The 134 liquidators diagnosed with ARS, acute radiation syndrome, were exposed to radiation levels far above what is considered safe, with doses as high as several sieverts in a short period. Many of the liquidators still struggle with health issues, and their access to healthcare has been inconsistent, particularly in the years following the collapse of the Soviet Union. Hello guys. Last week we spoke about the magnitude of radiation that was often deadly for people in Chernobyl, both citizens and liquidators. This time we're going to dive more into the consequences for the latter group. Before we start, a quick reminder that we're going to have a really good video in the upcoming days. Be sure to check out the trailer for Chernobylite 2 Exclusion Zone later and wishlist our game on Steam. But I don't want to keep you waiting. Let's start with today's episode. Chernobyl Disaster Impact, Part 3. Sacrifice of the Chernobyl Liquidators. The liquidators, the brave men and women tasked with cleaning up after the Chernobyl disaster, were some of the most severely affected by the radiation exposure. These workers faced immediate and long-term health consequences that have been documented in various studies, though the true extent of the damage is still unfolding. In the immediate aftermath of the disaster, many of the liquidators suffered from acute radiation syndrome, ARS, which manifests in symptoms like nausea, vomiting, dizziness, skin burns and, in severe cases, organ failure. The 134 liquidators diagnosed with ARS were exposed to radiation levels far above what is considered safe, with doses as high as several sieverts in a short period. Of those, 28 died within 3 months due to the effects of radiation exposure, highlighting the immense risks they faced in the early efforts to contain the disaster. The liquidator still has a broad meaning. It includes the so-called first responders, power plant workers, Pripyat hospital staff, firefighters and many more. So, the first victims of radiation exposure were, for example, Vasily Ignatenko, a brave firefighter, or Valery Khodemchuk, whose body was never found and probably is buried beneath the fallen reactor building. But beyond ARS, liquidators have experienced a range of long-term health issues, most notably an increased risk of cancer. Studies conducted in the decades following the disaster revealed that many liquidators were prone to thyroid cancer, leukemia, and other cancers associated with radiation exposure. Thyroid cancer, in particular, has been linked to exposure to radioactive iodine, 131, which is absorbed by the thyroid gland. Additionally, many liquidators have reported cardiovascular diseases, cataracts, and various neurological and psychological conditions. These health problems have continued to surface decades after their exposure, making it clear that radiation's effects are both immediate and persistent. The political landscape surrounding the disaster heavily influenced the way the liquidator's health was managed and perceived. In the Soviet Union, there was an effort to downplay the scale of the disaster and the risks faced by those involved in the cleanup. The Soviet government initially provided liquidators with minimal protective gear and did not equip them with dosimeters to accurately measure their radiation exposure. This lack of transparency was part of a larger effort to control the narrative surrounding Chernobyl, as the Soviet Union was already under immense political and economic pressure. As a result, many liquidators were unaware of the true danger they faced, and the full extent of their exposure was not accurately documented. From a Western perspective, the response to the health risks faced by the liquidators was more critical. International organizations and scientists raised concerns about the long-term consequences of radiation exposure. In the aftermath of the disaster, various studies were conducted to assess the impact on the liquidators, and Western governments and NGOs pushed for greater transparency in the Soviet response. The West viewed the Soviet Union's handling of Chernobyl as indicative of broader systematic issues, including the suppression of information and lack of regard for human safety. This critical stance influenced international relations and shaped the global response to nuclear safety in the years that followed. The liquidators were haunted by the disaster for years after it happened. One of the key concerns that emerged in the years following Chernobyl was the impact of radiation on DNA and the potential for long-term genetic mutations. Radiation is known to cause damage to the DNA in human cells, which can lead to mutations that disrupt normal cellular function. This damage can result in cancer, as mutated cells can multiply uncontrollably. For the liquidators who were exposed to higher doses of radiation, the risk was especially pronounced. Studies of the liquidators' children have shown mixed results regarding the inheritance of DNA mutations, with some studies identifying an increase in genetic mutations, while others found no significant increase in developmental anomalies. The decomposition of DNA due to radiation exposure is a complex process. When ionizing radiation strikes a cell, it can break the chemical bonds that hold the DNA strands together, leading to breaks in the DNA. These breaks can either be repaired by the cell's natural repair mechanisms or result in permanent mutations. In the liquidators, the high level of radiation exposure overwhelmed the body's ability to repair DNA damage, leading to a higher likelihood of mutations. This damage not only increases the risk of cancer, but also contributes to other health issues, such as cardiovascular disease, which has been observed in many liquidators. As the 1990s came to a close, there was a growing recognition of the need for long-term health monitoring and support for the liquidators. In response, various programs were established to provide healthcare and financial assistance to those affected by the disaster. International organizations such as the World Health Organization, WHO, and the International Atomic Energy Agency worked with the governments of Belarus, Ukraine, and Russia to assess the health needs of the liquidators and the broader public. One of the most significant initiatives was the creation of the Chernobyl Tissue Bank, which collects biological samples from individuals affected by the disaster to study the long-term effects of the radiation exposure on human health. In addition to healthcare initiatives, the international community also focused on improving nuclear safety and preventing future disasters. A lesson hard to learn. Chernobyl prompted a re-evaluation of nuclear safety protocols worldwide. Many countries adopted stricter safety standards for nuclear power plants, and there was an increased emphasis on transparency and international cooperation in the event of a nuclear accident. The International Atomic Energy Agency played a key role in facilitating this cooperation, organizing conferences and workshops to share knowledge and improve global preparedness for nuclear emergencies. However, despite these efforts, the legacy of Chernobyl continues to affect the liquidators and their families. Many of the liquidators still struggle with health issues, and their access to healthcare has been inconsistent, particularly in the years following the collapse of the Soviet Union. In Ukraine, for example, the healthcare system has faced significant challenges due to political instability and economic hardship, making it difficult for liquidators to receive the care they need. Additionally, the long-term psychological effects of the disaster have been under-researched, though many liquidators report suffering from anxiety, depression, and PTSD. We can't omit the panic and distrust the disaster had on the broad social spectrum. Many people in Eastern and Central Europe are still afraid that a similar situation may occur if any nuclear power plant malfunctions. The fear is mostly based on Chernobyl, unfortunately, but that's a case which haven't been properly attended to and which wasn't adequately explained. What were the reasons? How had it happened? And what safety measures are used now? These were issues not properly explained to the society. For instance, Chernobyl halted the Polish nuclear energy program and the construction of the first regular power plant in Żarnowiec. It was stopped in 1989 due to the post-Chernobyl protests. But the turn of the millennium brought renewed international attention to Chernobyl as the 20 and 25 anniversaries of the disaster approached. These milestones served as a reminder of the ongoing impact of the disaster and the need for continued support for those affected. International aid organizations and governments recommitted to assisting the liquidators, and new studies were launched to better understand the long-term health effects of radiation exposure. At the same time, the global community continued to push for improved nuclear safety standards, recognizing that the risks of another disaster could never be fully eliminated. Over the last 24 years, the long-term plans for supporting the liquidators have evolved, but challenges remain. While international cooperation has improved, many of the healthcare and support systems put in place after the disaster have been strained by economic and political difficulties, particularly in Ukraine. The ongoing war Russia brought to Ukraine has further complicated efforts to provide care to liquidators and other affected populations. Despite these challenges, the liquidators' role in containing one of the world's worst nuclear disasters continues to be recognized, and their health remains a priority for both national governments and international organizations. As always, I hope you have learned something new or interesting thanks to our video. Share your thoughts, and if you want to add something, please write us in the comments section. Same if you want to ask anything, feel free to comment. Remember to watch the Chernobylite 2 trailer and to wishlist our new game on Steam. That's it for today, guys. Take care, stay safe, and see you next week.